So we went to Detroit Diesel. As you can tell, me, Paul, and Josh are there, the three stooges. Mike's there with his dad. That's his brother right in front of us on the right. Josh and Will are with us, a couple truck drivers, a couple guys from the shop. We went down there on Friday, and we learned some stuff. Now, Mike and Rob had been here once before, so they wanted to bring the rest of us to come see how impressive Detroit Diesel is. So we went down there, and boy, was it interesting. Now, the first part here, I can't show you what we looked at. That's their turbo system that they have redesigned, and they did not want recording in there, so we did not record in there. Now, this is the new block on their new motors, and they've changed them dramatically from the old Series 60, which that was the last one right here that was produced there. That was their Series 60 block. So, and there is the DD16s. Those are what we're running in our Frieghtliners, and that goes down to their DD5s. Those are a slick little.
All the gears right off the podium, so your camshaft, rear compressor, rear pump. When this big gear goes, all the other gears go with it. Now, old two cycle engines, head gear trains in the rear, right? And I'm going to tell you the truth, they went to gear trains in the front because they knew emissions was coming, they wanted to take weight off. So before they understood all these emissions, they kept taking weight off, thinking that will reduce how much black stuff comes out, but they knew that they had to do more. We know that you can get an advantage in horsepower and torque with the gear train at the back end, like the two. So I don't have a big one to pull here back there. When we go to assembly line, I'm going to show you. I have, if I were to take this off, I have a number four idler gear here, I have a crank gear down there, and a number one idler there. Okay, and then I have my four or five, my idler four up top, the camshaft, the head. Okay, now.
And what we have here is they also make axles here. Diesel makes axles and transmissions, and she will explain this transmission to us.
So here's what I want you to see. So you have your main shaft, and most transmissions have two counter shafts. See how I have a counter shaft here, and see how I don't have one here. Okay. So your main shaft sits off the back end of the engine, and your two counter shafts force the main shaft to work with it. Now, what's impressive about this, it is 12-speed, an automated manual, but the guts of it is truly a manual. So if you open it up, you don't have to train anybody, you don't have to get more tools, and it's truly a manual transmission. But what we did is to take weight out because of all the density and the fuel economy that everybody's going after. It's complete aluminum housing, and I have one counter shaft. I wanted you to come closer because this is what I want you to see. I want you to look at the team on the gear. See how those are cut at an angle? That's called a helical cut too. It's a real quiet gear, but here's the advantage of that. This is your shifter. Okay. So now let's think that I have two counter shafts. I've got my main shaft, and those guys have straight cut teeth. So if you have a driver who doesn't look at RPM and know when it's the proper time to shift, what happens is that shifter's got to hit in between those straight teeth. Now he's not looking at RPM, so you know what happens? He's reefing through the gear, and he's wearing it. And this is what makes you go, you know, somebody like that. So he just started smiling. So I said, I know a lot of guys like that. So what happens is when he's reefing through the gears, that's what's wearing and that's what puts you in the shop. The helical cut tooth allows your shifter to have a wider position to put the shifter in. So when this guy's working this one and this shifts, it has a wider band to sit in. So you're not. A little, yes, but you're not reaping through your sweet spot, right? Because you don't want it to have so much wear that it's only in the shop. Right? So that's the difference. Now here's another slick thing too, two things. They spent like 4 years on designing this racking of the harness. Most transmissions, the harness frets on the back end and it throws you these ghost codes all the time, or it'll, or will put you down. So they made this rack where the harness actually sits inside of the rack and does these cutaways, and then they have these call-outs for the tie straps so that if you tie strap a harness and you do it too tight, then it crimps on the inside, and then everything gets hot and vibrates in a chase, and then you have a problem. So that's another thing they do. The last thing I want to tell you real quickly is on the inside of the transmission, you have all this oil slopping around on the inside of it, and they call that bathing or bathing, right? But I want you to think about you're going swimming right now, and you're underwater, and you take a stroll, right? Now, when you do that, you have this resistance, right? And so when we have all that oil slopping around on the inside of there, and they're going into a shift pattern, it's going up against that same resistance that you're doing when you're trying to swim, right? So what they did is this pipe right here is what's going to produce oil so that you're not creating that resistance against the fuse. And it will harness on the horsepower, so when you really need it, it can give you at least 50 horsepower without you working the gear train hard, without working the gears hard. So that's another thing they did. And it's not on this display, but when we rode by the line, then we also have, they came out this year with something that Mercedes-Benz designed. It's called a super finish gear. So what they do is after they cut the gears, they put them in this big drum, they put this little ball bearing through the drum, and they tumble around the gears, and then they make the...
Like you clean in a case
again. Yeah, exactly. And so you know how slick it gets, right? So they go faster, you know, the revolutions, pull the trigger. So the same thing with this. Instead of the teeth working through the gears, they slip in and out of the gear. And that helps save the life of the transmission as well. So those are like the cool things.
This is a pretty display here. They got set up. They got a motor set up with their transmission hooked up to it. Little display room here. Just kind of looks pretty neat. Right here they have a machine setting the sleeves in the block. The sleeves off to the right there were all rejected. They had a problem with their manufacturer, and they had some rejected that day. One thing that really, really impressed me with this, with Detroit Diesel, is how all this stuff is absolutely perfect. Any little problem with them sleeves or anything in the factory, it gets rejected. Everything has to be absolutely perfect. That was probably one of the most impressive things to me, as those sleeves to the right are just off a little bit. They had a problem, the manufacturer did, and these computers knew it, and it automatically rejected them. Just really impressive with how everything's done properly in that factory. It was really, really impressive. Here we're kind of walking in to see some more block work. Paul puts those glasses on. He looks like he's 10 years younger. He looks like he's a teenager. He does look young, which is funny, but they're doing work on the block right here. They're getting ground down to where they want them. And just impressive machines, how these work. That's awesome. Just very cool stuff.
Bottom drill that hole deep enough, and the gun is supposed to roll. rotate 10 times, but it's not only 9 and a quarter. That black box will tell us what hole is wrong and we'll stop the line and won't let us use it. If I pull a part out of a container from a supplier and it's not hot around or it's not flat enough or bolt is missing a thread, it'll find that as well. So it's going to look at the operator error, it's going to look at my machine process and my supply process. We're going to go ahead and cut through. See, you are welcome to chat with anybody, but please be mindful that they have 2 minutes and 4 seconds to do their work. I can't stop their production. After I train them and I ask if you get what I'm talking about, and they say yep, so you know what I do? I put them on a ladder and make them go up there and sign their name on that banner. So when they come into work every day, they've got their personal signature with their boss right next to the line, and they're thinking about what they're doing when they on their build spot.
Just extra parts.
Takes us on the tour, just so everybody understands, she has worked here since she was 16 years old. She knows everybody in the factory by name, over 2,000 employees. She knows everything about these motors, so when it comes to a woman and knowing about motors, she knows everything about these.
Just Eddie.
Take a look.
I'll get it.
strategies. Everywhere you see these orange pylon cones, we're going to have someone check behind what these operators did. So for an example, on the cab, and all the girls have to go to the front. If they are chatting with each other and you put it on backwards, and then we have less weight in it because of all that smoke and those galleries and those galleries, we would have a different torque path. It's going to be two so that you have a different bit of weight for the less volume.
We're on the line still here. We got Larry and Curly over there on the backside looking all things over. You know, they're learning lots here. They're probably going to be building motors here in the next couple weeks that are 10 times better than this. Just joking. But we were all thoroughly impressed with what we got going on here. Now, the one other place that I could not record was where they're testing their motors, doing some research and development on some motors, trying some new things out. I was not allowed to record in there either. And they had a bunch of motors lined up that they were testing on. I wasn't allowed to record those as well, but let me tell you what, very, very impressive stuff they got going on. I mean, they have some motors on there that have been running for an unbelievable amount of hours without oil changes. They're trying to, you know, throw some rods through some blocks, and they're trying to do all kinds of stuff in there. So that was a very impressive room. I don't want to talk a whole lot about it because obviously they probably didn't want me talking about it, but there was some stuff like that that won't be shown.
Again, there's a lot of them. I'm going to tell you what they're doing. We're going to walk straight through. He's now putting on a fuel pump. The guy behind him is putting on air compressor. We're going to cross over the line so I can show you one of my torques.
What's your name? So a little ride around on the cart some more. This place is over 3 million square foot under roof. So there's a lot going on. These are all motors that are done, and there is just rows and rows, as you'll see here in a second, of motor after motor after motor. Now, one thing that's really impressive with this place is if you look in the next couple clips, is they test every one of the motors they produce are ran there. So what you're going to see to the left here, all these buildings and all these like garage door type of things, all these motors are put in there, tested, dynoed, and then set out, and they go from there. But it was very impressive. Every single one of their motors goes into one of those bays and is tested.
So every engine will come into a test dyno. I have 14 codes by Celsius, another 12 in the back.
So we'll go for another ride here. If you look up to the like the very middle of the screen up top, there's actually motors up top rolling around. And I'm just kind of interested to look and see all the motors going around there. You can see them, they're hanging. They're all moving, getting something put on them. And then this section is all brand new right here. This is all being built right now for their new motors that's going to be built there. Now, I could be wrong that the DD8 is going to be built there. And this is all being set up for that. You can see how it's just all new stuff being built. There's a lot of people in there working, putting stuff together. So that's very impressive. And they brought that in to Detroit to get built there. So that was very impressive, all the new stuff they have going on. A lot of work. The one thing that did impress me too is how clean this place was. This place is spotless. I mean, everywhere is super clean. Unbelievably clean.
It's always the wrong time.
And that was also very, very impressive. So this is their whole new section for the new motors. That's the DD5 and the DD8. I see they're on the side. So that's what's getting built there. There's all the new little carts.
All new carts.
To hold the blocks to get assembled. That's just everything is being put together at this point right now. So I'm sure here in the near future they will be putting those motors there to get assembled. So there's 28 people. Look at that break room.
Oh,
hey, that's what you need, Will. Microwaves. TVs, fridges. Look at.
They got lockers.
Lockers. Rob.
Just know things. I know how propane and transformers.